you. I understand your dad is a member of the Art Club. Thank both of you and your souls. So some introductions. The school board is here on my left. The moderator, I'll be chairing today's meeting. Administrators from the SAU 56 are here. They may be asked to address items. My practice is to recognize members of the administrative staff, the SAU, even though they are non-voters, to address this body because they often have information to share. If any voter objects to that, please let me know. Members of the Budget Committee are there as well. Just past the administrators, they're sitting there today together. This is a deliberative session really run by the school board, but because the budget is a, the official budget is an item, a warrant article, the Budget Committee is here to respond to questions to provide additional information. Individual members of the Budget Committee may want to address the legislative body as a whole, as individuals, and you'll know when they're speaking for the committee, they'll be addressing the body from the table where they're sitting. You'll know when they're addressing you as individual voters because they'll come to the right room. I know we want to get to the business pretty quickly, but I want to share a few words about moderator's rules because deliberative sessions are a little bit different from regular town meetings. There are several copies of the moderator's rules in the auditorium. I don't think you need to have a copy in your possession, but you're welcome to review those rules. If you ever have questions about them or concerns about them, please let me know. This body can always overrule any of those moderator rules or any of the rules that I make as a moderator. It's important for me to remind you of that. Deliberative sessions are controlled by state law RSA 40:13. Each and every voter is a legislator, and I think it's really important to approach our work here today as legislators. The law limits a little bit of what we can do in a deliberative session. We can discuss and debate the warrant articles. We can ask for information about the warrant articles. With some limitations that we'll talk about as we go along, we can amend many of the warrant articles, but there are some exceptions to the scope of amendments that can be made in a deliberative session. What we'll do is I'll state that we're in discussion on a warrant article. I'll invite Ms. Nelson, who's the school board chair, to introduce the article to you. In the interest of time, there's going to be a full text copy of the warrant article on the screen in front of us. There are copies of the warrant, the full warrant, in the room. So in the interest of time, I will not read the article. If the body disagrees and wants me to read it to you in full, I will read it to you in full. To speak in favor or in opposition of a warrant article, please line up with the microphone in front of us so that everyone in the hall can hear you. Please begin by stating your name and street address so that the recording secretary can get a clear record. I'll recognize people at the microphone. I will also pretty liberally recognize members of the school board, school administrators, and members of the budget committee to respond or to answer questions. And I'm going to give them a little bit more leeway to have more time because they have important information to share. If you feel that I'm abusing that, again, you can let me know. I think I mentioned about addressing the body as individual citizens. If you're a member of a member of the school board, a member of the budget committee, just line up as an individual. But when you're speaking for your board, you're more than welcome to remain in the place where you're originally seated. To ask for information about a warrant article, please just look at me and say, Mr. Roth, moderator, I'd like to know X. And I'll look to Ms. Nelson or Ms. Small or an SAU administrator and ask them if they can respond and then allow them to respond. Please do not engage in crosstalk. It's one of the easiest things to do when we're in a meeting situation. You will kind of want to follow up and make your point. You're more than welcome to get an answer to your question, and then if you get the information and say, I have an additional question, you can look to me. If you get the information and want to say, and I disagree with warrant article 6, you can state that, but please don't get into a debate with a back and forth debate with officials that are to amend a warrant article, please write your proposed amendment down and then come to the microphone to present it. When I recognize you, you can say, Mr. Moderator, I have an amendment. Give it to me, and I'll read it to the clerk, and then you can present remarks for why you want to amend the article. As I mentioned, there are some limitations on what we can amend, how we amend things. I'll try to be helpful to voters who want to present an amendment so that you don't feel that we're that I'm manipulating technical legal rules to prevent you from getting your request before this body. But I just need to remind you that we all are subject to these state laws. I'll only accept amendments to the second degree. Don't worry what that means. I've never seen it. I've seen us get there once or twice in 40 years. When I find that debate is over, I'll declare that the warrant article will be placed on the ballot, on the official ballot for March, either as published or as amended, and then we'll move on to the next article. I hope you enjoyed today's meeting. I hope you feel that it's a good use of your time. I really appreciate the voters who have shown up, and the school officials and school administrators, and public officials who have shown up for today's meeting. That we're ready to go. Articles 1 through 4, there is no discussion to be had. The nominations for the various offices are closed by state statute, and those articles will appear on the ballot at town elections printed in the warrant. Warrant Article 5 is the school budget. Ms. Nelson for the school committee will introduce and provide a brief overview.
Good morning. I guess it's best if I step to the podium so I can also see. That's our business administrator, our superintendent,
I always call her the special ed director. That is not her title, but the wonderful person who covers all of our special ed students, K through 12. Not just Rollinsford grade school, but they also, one of the things the SAU staff has to do is oversee all of our students. Even our students who attend school in Maine, they must be overseen by a New Hampshire superintendent. So they do all that work. This year, and some of you may have noticed this in the papers, Summersworth had a shortfall in their budgeted amount, and they came to the SAU board. We're all a part of the SAU board, as is Summersworth. And they asked that we use SAU fund balance to help them meet their shortfall. We did that. And in so doing, we received a little bit of money back. We received 15% of what was approved back to us, and they received their 85% to help meet their shortfall. But because of that, we didn't have fund balance in the SAU budget, and the SAU fund balance, it's not in the budget, it's in the fund balance, that is usually used to offset the costs that each school district pays. So that that assessment went up this year by about $25,000. Normally, some of that would have been offset, but this year it was not. This year, we are also proposing, I call it right-sizing our custodial staff. A couple of years ago, we trimmed down the custodial staff and tried to figure out how to make it all work. They make it work. They work very hard. They work very long hours. But some things are two-people jobs, and sometimes we need two people here to do the work. So right now, we're trying to right-size it. It's an ongoing process how to do that. So what we're proposing this year is adding one part-time custodial staff 8 hours a week during the school year, and a proposed additional part-time custodian 20 hours a week during the summer. So it's a pretty reasonable way to try to figure out how to right-size that staff. And they have also had health and dental increases there. So, ongoing process there. I'd like to point out that with the utilities, because of our maintenance staff, they really keep an eye on utilities, especially electrical savings, and we have saved money. Our utility costs have gone down in the school over the last couple of years, and that is really due to the entire staff keeping an outlook on things, but the custodial staff keeping a real sharp eye on what's going on here. So one of the things that comes up sometimes is when you look at the budget, it looks like we've had sort of a large decrease in our maintenance budget, and that's because of the way warrant articles from last year are sort of accounted for in last year's budget as compared to this year's budget. We can talk more about that as we go forward. The biggest ticket, as you look through there, you'll see a few things listed that are not on warrant articles. The biggest ticket item is the need to replace the bell and phone system within the school. This one is old. It is less than reliable, and it does need to be replaced. It was also mentioned, for those of you who've been around for a few years, in the IBEA study that was done 4 years ago, maybe 5 years ago now, it was mentioned then that it needed to be replaced. So we're certainly looking at doing that this year. And we're hoping to do it out of this year's budget. We also intend out of this year's budget to address safe and secure doors, all the doors around to be locked properly, to be unlocked properly, all those things. And we are also plan to be addressing out of this year's budget, not the budget that we're voting on this year, but for next year, but this year's budget, cupola repair. So we can finally be proud of the cupola that sits on top of our building. So the actual budget, and again, I've broken it out into three pieces because I think it's important to see it this way. The RGS budget, you can see there at the top. SAU transportation and school board expenses, because you have those expenses whether or not we have RGS, is sort of the next line. It's about $500,000 for all of that. And then the Marshwood Summersworth portion of the budget for a total of the operating costs of $5,657,232. We do have anticipated revenue coming in that will offset. It gets confusing because revenue, you can try to count revenue before it comes in, but you really can't. We do have, the state has promised us a certain amount of money, but the state is not always able to live up to its obligations. So we do, we are expecting money from the state. We are expecting unanticipated money from the state, and that is for, from the Keno kindergarten bill that passed a while ago. And the state has let us know that we are eligible for it and that we will be receiving it, but they have, are not yet able to tell us how much we will receive from that. So revenues are really pretty much an unknown at this point. But there will be offsetting revenues to this budget. I think everyone's aware that by law, we have to raise the full amount of the budget. It doesn't mean that you will be taxed the full amount of the budget. Any offsetting revenue will be used first before the tax rate is set. So some of the accomplishments that had happened in the last year with community support, we completed three-phase power. I think everybody has to be a hip hip hooray for all of us, the community and certainly the school. It was a three-year project and it is completed. We have abated all known asbestos, and everyone can groan because I think we've said that 2 years in a row. And I know that this year, when we were replacing some windows in the annex, we actually found some more asbestos. There are things that you just never know where it is in this building, but we continue to say that we've abated all known asbestos. And we've also replaced the mandated ADA compliant lifts that was completed this last summer. Then with operational budget savings, we've accomplished, installed lighting, upgraded plumbing, upgraded ceiling tiles, upgraded parking and playground areas, stepped up in-house maintenance of the building, stepped up efficiency of the boilers, and replaced sheds. And this budget allows us to continue doing that, especially with the proposed additional custodians with the hours that they're going to be adding. And that brings us to the conclusion. We will now open this up to discussion.
Any discussion on Warrant Article 5?
Does not change. What I did for the what you're looking at is the RGS budget.
Correct.
In the RGS budget is included SAU, all SAU costs, even though it's not RGS we pay, it's not just our K through 6 students we pay them for K through 12, transportation, all transportation. I take that back. We've broken out a portion of transportation. So not all the transportation is included in the RGS budget, only a portion of it, which makes it a little difficult to look at. And the school board, which again oversees all students, K through 12, not just K through 6. So that's the difference. The difference, the 300 whatever you're talking about, is transportation to middle school and high school, and it is SAU costs and school board.
So the $3,152,000 operating budget for the grade school includes transportation and SAU costs.
And school board, yes.
Yes, okay. So it's up really half. It's
you would split that up between all of the schools.
So let's, if you have a question, Ms. St. Hilaire, go ahead and address it to me. If you want to make a statement to the warrant article, you may.
Just clarify that. So just in looking at the budget, as I understand it, the increase for the budget this year for operating costs for all of the schools is about $102,000, is that correct?
Question for the chair.
Well, it's an interesting question. If you look in the budget that you have in front of you, you will see that it comes out to be a savings. But we understand that budgeting is complex, and that some of these things we have to look at more closely as we go forward. But if you base it on the budget you see in front of you, you will see all the way down the line, RGS, and then at the very, very end, when they're all brought together, a savings in the budget. So I really can't answer that. I mean, I think I understand the question you're asking, but if I go by the budget that we're all looking at, you see a savings in there. Now, so I guess I'm not quite sure what you're asking.
So just follow up.
Go ahead.
So I took out the capital, the smart articles for the lift and the electrical previous power, and just the operating costs. It appears that $102,000 is the increase from last year, and that almost $85,000 of that is for the grade school, and $17,000 or so of that is for the middle school and high school. Just looking for clarification on that.
So the question is requesting clarification of what?
In fact, the operating costs are increased by $100,000. $85,000 of which goes towards the grade school, $17,000 of which goes towards the middle school.
I do appreciate the question. Budgeting is obviously complex, and when you have a $5.5 million budget, it's kind of complex. I think that the board has been working for the last number of years to understand more about the budget, how the budget is done, how it works. One of the things we can do better is to figure out how best to present it to make sure that we're being very, that we're really comparing apples to apples rather than bananas. But to say that it's increased is I can't really say it's increased. There's no magic to the budgeting. We have a number of layers of people who spend their professional jobs, their professional lives doing this budget. This budget indicates that we have a savings. This is the way it has been done for years. Is there a better way to show some of that? Very possibly, and we are going to work this coming year to work on that. But what we see here is not what we end up paying as a town, and that's the most important thing to remember. Or it's an important thing to remember. We have no idea what the revenues will be yet. I don't think I can clarify any more except that we are presenting what we have seen here. We understand the complexities of it, and sometimes it looks like maybe we're talking about fruit. It's not apples to apples, but oranges to oranges. And there may be a better way to present it. But now that's about all I can say. Thank you for your question.
So basically, we can't really rely on those numbers.
So let's keep that as a comment on the same there. If you have a question, go ahead and state the question. If you've got a comment, if you believe that the warrant article is not fairly presented, just make that statement.
Last question is, can you confirm that the majority of the increase for the middle school and the high school was special ed tuition cost to private schools?
I can confirm that. It says so right in the budget, and I can confirm that. Yes, and I would like to point out that that this warrant article was approved by both the budget committee and the school board. So, and I agree with that.
Thank you. Is there further discussion on warrant article 5?
Good morning, this is Angie Rick, and I'm the governor. I'm also the chair of the select board, and I have some information that I just offered to try to clarify numbers that are real versus the numbers that may have been difficult to understand. And so the town actually is the entity that pays, you know, for taxation for school expenses. And to clarify that, in fact, or confirm that, in fact, the school has reduced their expenses in December of 2017. We have a manifest from the school district that reduced the monthly outlay that the town pays on behalf of the school by roughly $17,000. That's a month. So that's an annual decrease in what the town has paid for its school expenses of $120,000 per year. That happened in December, so for the December through the next 12 months, there's an actual decrease in what the town is paying because of money that the school had saved from the close of the 2016. Forget the year. I get confused with school years, fiscal years. So we're paying $120,000 less per year on behalf of the school district.
Thank you, Mr. Leach. Yeah. Mr. Leach, if you'd like to address the body, go ahead, right, step right up to the mic. I'm going to make sure that there isn't more debate in the deliberative session.
Good try.
I'll treat that as an expression of concern.
What's the more question?
It looks like debate or discussion on Article 5 is at a conclusion. The warrant article will be placed on the ballot. Article 6 relates to approving cost items related to the collective or included in the collective bargaining agreement between the Rollinsford School Board and the Rollinsford Education Association, which relate to increases in salaries and benefits and decreases in health insurance premiums. Ms. Nelson from the school committee will introduce the article.
Thank you. I didn't all fit on one page in the, so there's the first page and the second page continued. Both the budget committee and the school board recommend this article. So I'll give you a little background on this. Some of the highlights on the collective bargaining agreement this year. We are placing all teachers on the correct experience level. In education speak, that's called a step. So all teachers will be placed on their individual experience level where they belong. All paraprofessionals will receive a 50-cent an hour increase. In exchange for this, in essence, because that's what negotiations is about, a little give and take, the union has agreed to a change to a lower cost health plan. We are moving from an HMO to a consumer-driven health plan if this passes. In the next slide, and there's a handout of the next slide as well, it will show you the projected savings if we go, if the town, it, votes to move to this plan, the savings the town can enjoy it goes out 5 years anyway, the one that's handed out. So in the first year, we can see back here, in the first year, we save $47,700, and I think there's a little thing here that makes this, I don't know, anyway, sort of the less health savings, $47,763, that's our first year's savings. Our second year, by the second year, if we do change health plans, we will save $98,000 as compared to our current health plan. And by the fifth year, it's up to $250,000 that we have saved if we change health plans compared to our current. And the other item is that teachers with 8 or more years of experience will receive a $1,000 increase. And that is to help defray the out-of-pocket expenses of moving to the new health plan. We go to the next. This is what there's a handout out back. I don't know if you have it with you, but this just shows the comparison is between the current health plan, the proposed health plan, assuming a 5% increase in healthcare costs, and we see that we have these kinds of savings. They are significant savings. The first year, the $47,763, and the second year, 97, almost 98, third year, 150. That's cumulative savings compared to the current health plan that we are on. I will entertain questions, but I would like to just state once again that we have not had a collective bargaining agreement pass in this town for 6 of the last 9 years. That means that we have a number of teachers who can be, who are as many as 6 years not paid for their experience, 6 years. And we, and it's a, so we think it's a, the board had felt very strongly this year that it was time to address that inequity and to move forward with that. We have 6 teachers who are affected and for a total of 20 years of experience that has not been paid. 20 years. Think of that for a minute. So anyway, we think that this is a good deal for everyone. The town has, looking forward, long-term savings that we can see with the health plan, and we address the inequities in salary. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson. This meeting can discuss and debate the article relating to cost items in the collective bargaining agreement. We received legal advice from the school board, school board's council, indicating that under state law, this article cannot be amended. So with that, I open the floor for discussion.
June Gallup, 535 Spence Street. I'm just a little concerned about the healthcare cost. You guys have a guarantee that this healthcare provider that you're waiting with is going to be here in the next 10 years?
So question to the moderator, to Ms. Nelson.
Oh, it's an excellent question. I wonder if any of us have guarantees on health care providers. But this is school care. It is, I don't know if you want to get any, anyone else wants to speak to it, but this is the provider of health care to school districts in the state of New Hampshire. And by state law, they have to, I mean, the state has to provide a certain I'm sorry, you're wondering, do you want to add?
I was just going to say, it's the same company we have now. It's just a different plan with that company. So we're not switching companies.
Okay.
If that, yeah, that's, if that, that does, that, does that help?
Sort of. I'm just concerned because even when you change healthcare, you go from an HMO to a computer, that with the increased longevity of our staff, the mod changes. So are they going to increase our rates based on the gender and or longevity of our staff, like most other companies do? We end up paying more for health insurance.
That's, so obviously, I'm sorry.
You anticipated me, but it's treated as a question through the moderator.
Thank you. So none of us can predict the future. All we can do is project based on what we know today. And today, assuming a 5% increase, and our increases in the past years, in the past 5 years, have been as high as 17% one year and as low as 2% another year. It all depends on where we're falling in certain things. And that's a percent increase from the health insurance company. So we just chose an average of 5%, and we did projecting out, and all we can project is what we know today, which is our current cost of healthcare compared to the cost of the new plan costed out today. That's all we can do. And that shows us the savings that we can anticipate. We know the first year's cost is pretty, we know that. That's, but again, that also assumes the same coverage. Other things that could change healthcare costs. We could suddenly have 5 teachers decide that their spouse has healthcare coverage they would take. That would lower our healthcare costs. It wouldn't necessarily, it wouldn't lower individual premiums, but it would lower the district's healthcare costs. I mean, there's so many different factors that affect it. So you know, all we can do is base it on what we know today.
Based on the history of the last 5 years of health insurance cost rise, is 5% conservative or is that liberal enough to make sure that we're not paying more? I know my insurance in the past 5 years have been paying more.
So we'll treat it as a question for the moderator about increases.
Thank you, Charlie. I agree. So the idea of using 5% was just to, now, if they increase by 10%, guess what? The town saves more. The town saves more with the new health plan than it does with the old health plan. Because we are making the assumption that if health care goes off up for one plan, it will go up for the other plan as well.
Okay, so the cost would still go up. It would just be a savings over what our
Absolutely. I'm sorry. Yeah, that's a very good way to do that. And yes, and that's what the graph shows. It goes up for both health plans. And the savings, if the percentage gets higher, the savings get actually more.
But the cost still goes up.
But the cost still, I'm not saying it's going to stay at the same cost it is today. No.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. At the bottom, you just noticed Ms. Small has indicated to me that she wants to speak, and she's given the previous speaker a lot of room physically so that she doesn't feel crowded. But it's a good visual cue for me to know that there are additional speakers. So please, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Michelle Small. I'm the
Chair of the Select
Board. I'm here as a citizen. Concept is also one that I can't wrap my head around from a numbers standpoint, but the way I look at it is if I have a Mercedes and every year I buy a Mercedes, it's going to cost me $100,000. Will it go up? Sure. If every year I buy an Escort, or Escort, which I have driven in my lifetime, I'm paying probably $20,000 every year if I buy a new car. To me, that is a visual I can picture, that every year the cost for Mercedes will go up, but if the town chooses to purchase an Escort instead, that will go up as well, but at a different cost. And I just would like to share that, because for me, that makes it a little more understandable.
Thank you. I don't understand the math. You say you're saving $47,000 this year, and you're increasing 5% next year, and you jump to 97. 5% added on to 47 does not come up to 97. How did you come up with a $97,000 savings in the second year?
So is that a question about how the cost of savings were computed? The question through the moderator for this month?
Yes, again, all we know is what we know today. So if you look at the bottom, the very bottom line, and if you have...
Mr. Guyon, please let Ms. Nelson respond. Let's try to avoid the crosstalk. It's just going to confuse everyone.
All right. So if some of you who have your charts can look at this bottom line. So in the first year, we have a savings of 47,763. In the second year, we have a savings of 50,151. If indeed we stay on the, that's the difference between the current health plan in the second year and the health plan that is being proposed in the collective bargaining agreement. If you add those two together, you get whatever it is, 97, whatever, coming up. Now, the whole point is, using Michelle's analogy, which is, I think, excellent, is that in order to have any savings at all, we have to buy the Ford Escort. That's the amount that's on the warrant article, $39,000. That's essentially what it's costing us to buy the Escort. And then every year after that, we will have savings. Now this savings, the $50,000, is compared to if it is the same plan. Now, hopefully next year, we will be on the less expensive plan. So will we actually save $50,000 next year? No, we won't the second year. We won't, because we've already, but if we don't go to it, we won't save anything. That's and, you know, when you make projections, you can only do it on what you know today.
That's the point.
So
we'll fall. I think you're just inflating it by doing it that way. Because you're not really saving 97, in my opinion.
Thank you, Mr. Fader.
So I live at 426 Washington Street. Is this plan giving comparable benefits from the previous plan, or do we know that we're going to be losing anything? Are they comparable plans?
Question to the moderator, to Ms. Nelson, are the plans comparable?
Yes, the plans are comparable. There is the possibility of more out-of-pocket expenses that they will have to meet themselves, hence the additional money added to them, to experience level 8 in order to help defray some of those costs.
So my follow-up question is that compensation for the level 8 employees, is that long-term, 1 year? Did you miss that, or if you explained it?
So a question through the moderator about step level 8 and how that was communicated.
Yes, because it is, because the increase was put into a step, into the experience level, it is ongoing. It will remain a permanent part of their salary.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Suzanne, you were not in the right lane. I'm going to try to explain that. So my understanding of that chart is that the very top line is the projected increase of the plan that the teachers are currently on if it increases by 5% per year. The second line is the projection of the plan that is being proposed in the collective bargaining agreement. And that line goes up again by a projected 5%. So you're saying, okay, the top line, if we don't make any change, that's how much that line goes up. If we do make a change, that's how much the line goes up, assuming a 5% increase on the old plans. And you can see that the bottom plan doesn't go up quite as sharply as the top plan does, because we're starting from a smaller base. 5% of a smaller number is a smaller number. And so the first year, you say, the difference between the two plans is $47,000. The second year, assuming the 5% increase on both plans, the difference is $50,000-some-odd. If you add those two numbers together, 47,000-some-odd and 50-something-some-odd thousand, you get to 90-some-odd thousand. That's how that 92,000 whatever figures been reached.
Further debate on Article 6, Mr. Cameron.
If you're saving 47,000 one year, you can't get it the next year too. So you're only going to be saving the 5%. That's the point I was trying to bring up.
Thank you. Further debate or discussion on Warrant Article 6? I find that the debate on Warrant Article 6 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 7 relates to raising and appropriating money to replace the roof on the grade school annex and kindergarten. Ms. Nelson from the school committee will introduce the article.
So there it is. There's the warrant article written out to see if we'll, I'm sorry, is that the right one? No, sorry. Went to the wrong one. To see if we'll raise and appropriate $93,000 for the annex and kindergarten roof. That's back here behind us, behind all of you. Again, this warrant article is recommended by both the budget committee and the school board. In the IDEA study, which many of us go back to as we look at these, which was done again 4 or 5 years ago, it was called out in there that the annex roof should have been replaced in 2012, and that the kindergarten roof is due to be replaced this year. These are flat roofs. We feel it's prudent to keep up as we go forward, and so we are asking for $93,000 to do that. It's again, it's a flat roof. There are seams between the two roofs. We feel it's much better to do them both together than to let anyone to let them go. And I guess the board feels strongly that should that roof fail in any way, that's a big that That's a bad thing to happen for all of us. We do not want to see that happen, so we do want to keep up with the maintenance of those flat roofs. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson. Is there a question or a discussion on Article 7? Seeing none, I find that... Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Lee.
Nathaniel Lee, 71 Heritage Drive. You're looking to raise an appropriate $33,000. If the cost of the roof is $60,000, what happens to the remaining funds?
Question through the moderator regarding the disparity between the quoted cost and the...
A good question. It simply gets... we actually don't raise and appropriate it because it all comes out in the wash when the tax rate gets set next year, or we raise it and goes back to the town.
So you're able to 406 Washington Street. You said part of the roof was due to be replaced in 2012 and part of it this year. About how old is the roof? Do we know?
Question to the moderator about the age of the roof.
I'm not sure I have that information. The annex was built in the 60s. I'm assuming some work has happened on the roof since then. I'm not sure if it's been fully replaced. Kate, do you have?
So the 2012 would have been 20 years, which is the length of specialty, whatever that would be.
Yeah, 92.
So probably 27 years now, 26 years now, and then the annex would be 20 years this year.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Yeah, just to clarify, we're assuming that it was replaced.
Judy, I'm going to interrupt you. So just so that everybody in the hall can hear, the principal estimates that it's somewhat in excess of 20 years, approximately 27.
We're assuming that it was done at the right time. The roof has a life of about 20 years. The annex was built in 1998, 1999. I think kindergarten opened in 1999, so let's say it was built in 1998. So that's the 20 years now to be done this year for the kindergarten. The annex was built in the 60s, and assuming that it was done at the 20-year level, it was done sometime in the late 80s, early 90s. We're assuming that. We actually don't know. We haven't looked back. I know that it was called out in the IEA study that it should be done in 2012. I assume that it was done around in the early 90s.
And is it the assumption of the report that you're quoting that the previous roofing job removed all of the materials that were on the roof and started new, or did they build over the roof that was there?
So a question to the moderator regarding how the previous repair was done.
That information is not in the report, and I do not know the answer.
I'm just wondering if we're going to run into asbestos or anything when we try and redo the roof, and if that will increase the budget line or the warrant article to then remove asbestos in the roofs.
So there's actually a layer that was not removed the very first time. It's a substance that they do not remove, and so there will be more. I apologize, this will be in layman's terms, but there was a layer on the roof the last time it was done that they did not take off, and they will not take that off this time. So there's two layers they will remove. They'll lay down, it's actually like a sandy gravel material, and then they'll top it back, and they will match the kindergarten roof to that. I have the terms in my office if you want me to get them, but there's a layer that will not be removed that stays on.
Okay. And there was a question about the discrepancy in the cost. Does that cover removal of the materials? Because from my understanding, recently having my roof done, is that they don't necessarily go to the regular trash because it's a building material.
Question to the moderator about the disposal of the waste.
Again, I do not have the answer to that question.
Thank you very much.
Is there any further discussion on Board Article 7? I find that the discussion and debate on Board Article 7 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 8 relates to raising and appropriating money to be added to the Rollinsford School Building Capital Reserve Fund. Ms. Nelson from the School Committee will introduce the article.
As you can see up there, it's very straightforward. It is We have to say, raise and appropriate $75,000 to go into our building reserve fund. However, no money will be raised by taxation. This will not affect our tax rate in any way. This is money that, should we have money left in our current year's budget, will go into the building fund. We recently learned that we had that we could use this building fund as a capital improvement project fund. And we have some rather large projects coming up, and we realized as a board that we need to start planning for those, which we didn't realize we could do before by putting money in this fund, but we can. So we are proposing putting a pretty substantial amount into that building fund. It will bring the total up to about $180,000, $190,000 in that fund, which we want to keep growing. We do have some large ticket items coming up down the line over the next few years. Again, all called out in that famous IBEA study, something we were aware of, but they were well called out there for us. So we're trying to plan ahead on this. Again, no money will be raised by taxation for this. And again, recommended by both the budget committee and the school board.
This meeting can discuss, debate, and amend warrant Article 8. And seeing none, I find the debate on warrant Article 8
hold
is
it.
Over. Oh, Ms. Dionne.
Nancy Dionne, 44 Rollins Road. This is the assumption that you'll have $75,000 left in this current year's budget, correct?
Question through the moderator about the amount that, or the assumptions related to the amount in the to be added to the reserve fund.
No, this only applies if we have $75,000 left. We have no idea, of course.
Yeah, I just wanted everyone to realize that it's actually coming out of the current year's budget, and that's where we would be getting the money from.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson. Ms. Dionne. Ms. Leopold.
Can you please inform me what is on the capital reserve plan or building improvement list?
Question to the moderator regarding the
yes, some of the items coming up are heating throughout the building. Our boilers are very old, plus the infrastructure that carries the heat around is very old. Again, if you look back at the IBEA study, which is available, I believe, online, or we can make it available online, these things were called out at that time. So there's the heat throughout the building. There's ventilation throughout the building. We are looking, again, been called out an entrance configuration, secure entry and entrance to the building. And so essentially those three large items are all between $300,000 and $400,000 each from the IBEA study, which is already 4 or 5 years old.
And based on that report, how much money or funding funds would we need to complete these projects?
Question to the moderator regarding the total amount of the capital improvement fund.
You're asking about the IBEA study, correct?
Yes. Of those things that are on the list.
Yes. Again, from 4 or 5 years ago, the total, and we've already addressed quite a few of those items in-house, some of them in-house, luckily they've come off that way, was just under $3 million. So I think it was about $2,700,000. We've already addressed a number of those.
So I understand that over the last few years we've been picking away at this long list of things that we've been asked to upgrade.
Question regarding the progress made on that capital improvements plan.
Yeah, absolutely. As I may have mentioned back when we were talking about maintenance and the custodial staff here and the administration and the school board, we've all been working together to attack many of those items so that we don't improvements to plumbing, electric ceiling tiles. The lifts, all those things were called out on that study, and we've addressed many of them over the last 3 or 4 years. As the school board said we would 4 years ago, we're trying to address these items so that we don't have to have these huge million-dollar expenses of things. So, yes.
So can you confirm that if all those articles as written are approved by the voters, that the total budget next year will look like $5,864,314, an increase of $133,000 in change?
Question to the moderator regarding the next year's budget, projected budget?
This total proposed budget.
The total for this proposed budget.
Including all the warrant articles.
Ms. Nelson?
No, I haven't done the math, but it would be, it would essentially be what we saw for the operating plus the 93. So if you've done that math, fine, I have not.
So the building improvement, the teacher contract would be considered as well?
The teacher contract, yes. The building improvement, no, because none of that is to be raised by taxation. So that would not increase the budget itself.
Thank you.
Any discussion or debate on warrant article 8? I find that the debate is over. The article will be placed on the ballot as published. Article 9 relates to establishing a regular education tuition expendable trust fund, and Ms. Nelson from the school committee will introduce the article.
This proposal by the school board is to establish a tuition trust fund. So as I mentioned, as we talked about the operating budget, I said we plugged in two contingency students for our school because of the big surprise we got a couple of years ago with so many students moving in. What this will allow us to do if we establish this trust fund is to remove that from the operating budget so that every year we can stop asking in the operating budget to raise money for contingency students that we don't know if we're gonna have or not. In place of that, we will have a tuition trust fund, which we do not propose putting any raising money by taxation for. Again, we propose to fund it out of money that may be or may not, hopefully would be left over from other budgets. So that contingency right now in the current operating budget is about $10,000 a student. That's the base tuition that we would need to look at. We build it up to whatever we felt comfortable with. Right now we're asking for $20,000 in the operating budget, which we would not have to ask for if we had this tuition fund set up. And again recommended by both the budget committee and the school board.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson. Again, this deliberative session can discuss, debate, and amend that article. Ms. Lippert.
By establishing this fund, is it to be used for a contingency of students going to the school of record, or to the school of choice?
Question to the moderator regarding the use to be made of the trust funds.
It is only to school of record.
And a follow-up question. If our special ed fund is depleted, would this trust fund be allowed to be used to cover special ed costs?
Yeah, a question regarding the possible application of funds in the trust fund to special ed costs.
It would not. Trust funds are set up for very specific reasons. They cannot cross each other. So at the moment, we feel that our special ed trust fund is sufficient. We certainly hope that it is. I'm actually glad that you brought that up. For any of you who read Foster's yesterday morning, two of the cities around us, Rochester and Dover, have both had over $1 million shortfalls in their budgets due to special ed costs. I can't say enough about the work that our our SAU office does, our special ed director, not her real title, does to make sure that we do not fall into that category. That we have never had to come back in my time, I don't know if in Pam's time or not, we have never had to come back to the town and say we need more money because we did not plan properly for special education. It is the one thing we do not know, we never know. And if you read this, you will see where the Rochester superintendent said, he was shocked, I tell you, to find out that they had that big a shortfall in special ed, and yet it happens. So I'm glad you brought it up, so thank you.
So to use the funds within the trust fund, to withdraw the funds from the trust fund, will you have to go before the voters in a special meeting or on another?
So the question about how do we draw money from the trust fund?
A very good question. We have two current trust funds, which we do have to go to the voters for to ask to withdraw. That would be the building fund and the special ed trust fund. This trust fund we are setting up differently so that we can react more quickly to it, and then only the school board would need to approve removing the money for tuition and putting it immediately to use. Thank you.
For future reference, will this be included within the budget in its own separate section, line item?
Question regarding where the trust fund would be
allocated. Yes, absolutely. Just like we asked to put $75,000 into the building trust fund, this year we're simply asking to start it with a dollar. Should this pass, next year there would likely be a warrant asking to fund it.
She answered it.
Okay. The discussion and debate on Article 9. I find that the debate on Article 9 is open. The article is published and been placed on the ballot. Article 10 allows this meeting to transact any other business that may legally come before it. Is there any other business that can legally come before it? Mr. Dunn?
Simple question. If all the warrant articles pass and the budget pass, how much is the tax increase?
So a question about the impact on the tax rate if the budget and all the warrant articles pass. Ms. Nelson, you can.
Well, I know it sounds like a simple question, but let's remember the tax rate was just set for 2017 in November. So I can tell you what each one maybe, but I cannot tell you what the tax rate will be because we don't know until the DRA sets it in November. So I really can't tell you what we'll do because a lot of things come into play. When Suzanne Huber mentioned that the burden for the town of Rumsford went down by $17,000 a month, $120,000. That is a result of the DRA setting the tax rate for 2017. The DRA will set the tax rate for 2018 in November. So we don't know what the tax rate is going to be. Now, it's not a simple question. I can tell you that based on today, what each piece will cost. I mean, what the estimated projected cost, but we have no idea because it's not a simple, it's not a known thing. And I'm assuming you're waiting for those figures. I have them somewhere. Here they are. In very small print for some reason. So for the operating budget itself, it is a reduction of 26 cents. For the collective bargaining agreement, it is an increase of 14 cents. For the annex and kindergarten roofs, so for the $93,000, that's an increase of 33 cents. For the capital of $75,000, there is no tax impact. For the $1, we're also saying there's no tax impact. And the total of all of those, all added up, is a total estimated, no way of really knowing, 21 cents.
So just quickly, I think if I understood the presentation you made today, the piece that's the most, it's the revenue. The revenue, because the revenue offsets what we have to pay. And so until you actually see what revenue has been received, it's difficult to understand. So you're estimating based on expenditures, but then there's the revenue that can offset the expenditure. And it seems like the largest unknown, the one that you haven't even built into your budget, is the Keno revenue. So all of that will help to reduce whatever revenue we get from Keno will help to reduce that 20, what is now estimated to be a 21 cent increase in the current tax rate as it currently exists.
So again, a further question about tax rates.
Yeah, if I may, that is it is complex, but I would just like to be very specific. We do not build revenues in to any of these warrant articles. We are legally obligated to raise by taxation every penny that we need. We will not be taxed. Our tax rate will not go up that much, what you see up there, what you've seen up there, because there will be revenue. But we can't account for revenue yet. We don't know what it's going to be. So we are raising the full amount, taking into account no revenue from the state, no revenue from Keno Kindergarten, no revenue from anywhere else.
Thank you.
And that's how all of that went. Yes, thank you.
So before I take that up, just say a little.
Just a follow-up to Mr. Brown's comment. The 26 cent reduction in the operating budget, isn't that because it's the warrant articles from last year are not going to be in the cents budget? Isn't that the savings is the warrant articles?
So it sounds like it's a question, not a comment, but a question about the impact of previous year's warrant articles.
So Ms. Nelson said the operating budget is down 26 cents proposed. And my question is isn't that reduction because the warrant the difference of the warrant articles that were included in this year's budget?
Question regarding the impact of other warrant articles on the budget.
Again, as I said before, it can sometimes be confusing. It is based on what you see in this budget. That is all. This is what we can see in this budget. And we will work on finding better ways, possibly going forward of how to present that. But it is based on what we see in this budget, which is how it has been done year after year after year after year. So I mean, I really don't know quite how to answer that. So, but it is based on this budget, the one that shows us the full amount that we have to raise, the $5 million.
So just to follow up, because there was $170,000 in warrant articles in this year's budget. So I assume that reduction of 26 cents is that.
That's the comment?
Yes.
Thank you. So before asking for a motion to adjourn, I want to say a few thank yous. The administrative unit and the school staff have been very helpful getting this meeting set up. There's a lot that goes into the kind of a landscape of a meeting like this, and the logistical arrangements were outstanding. I want to thank Ms. Nelson and the school board. They met with me ahead of time so that we could have a well-organized meeting this morning, and appreciate their time and effort to get things organized. Similarly, the budget committee has coordinated with us in terms of trying to make this meeting run smoothly. And I also want to thank the supervisors of the checklist for their time and their assistance this morning. Most of all, I want to thank the voters who turned out for this meeting. You've given up part of a busy weekend, I assume, and we appreciate your involvement in this civic activity. The principal has asked me to do two things. One, if you can stay for a couple of minutes and put some chairs and tables away, that would help them get ready for gym classes on Monday. And I was surprised that I would need to say this, but I need to remind parents to pick up their children at daycare. With that, I raise my hand. So moved. Any objection? I find that this deliberative session is adjourned.